to get started is that of being a professional bridesmaid. Did you know you could hire somebody? I think she makes about $36,000 a year. You can hire, but she gets the dress, I guess, too. You can hire somebody to stand with you at your wedding. Now, how meaningful friendship. Sergio Garcia, the golfer, has been at or near the top of his game for years, but he's also endured many embarrassing slumps. He was interviewed once and he said, "When you're on your way up, everybody loves you. But when you're heading down..." Thank you.
Well, good morning. It's so good to see you today. As you can tell, things are a little different on the stage, and we'll talk about that in just a few minutes. So good to see you today. God's Word tells us what we're supposed to be about today. It's right here in Psalm 100. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before Him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is He who made us, and we are His. We are His people, the sheep of His pasture. Enter His gates with thanksgiving and His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him and praise His name. For the Lord is good, and His love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. Isn't that good? God's Word is good, and it's great to see you today. Let's stand together, and would you please greet one another as we prepare for our worship time together.
River flowing from your heart, filling every part of our brain.
Thank you. Please be seated. Thank you so much. You may be wondering, who are all these people up here on the stage with us this morning? Our choir and orchestra are taking the day off, and they're sitting out there. You're out there, and they're in Sunday school and Bible fellowship this morning. But we have guests on the stage with us today, and guests in other places in the room today, and I want to introduce who they are. Rob Veal is here. He says that this is his last act as the minister of music at his church at Northview in Lewisville, Texas, because he's going to become the executive pastor. And Rob's going to sing the solo in just a minute on Old Church Choir. And then, so if you're here from Northview in Lewisville, Texas, raise your hands. Good, good. And also Crossroads Baptist Church in the Woodlands, Texas. Rocky Gilmore is a worship pastor. If you're here from Crossroads, and some of you are out there in the room, raise your hand so we can see you. Okay, good, great. And Olive Baptist Church in Pensacola, Florida, John Tyner is the worship pastor. Raise your hands if you're from Olive. Okay. And then there are actually seven churches that are represented here on stage in some way. Raise your hands if you're one of the other churches. Okay. Got a few folks that just joined in. And so thank you so much for being here to lead us in worship today. Later on in the worship service, the handbell choir will play. And we've been privileged this weekend to have world-renowned, really, Cynthia Dobrinsky, who is a composer, clinician, organist as well, written so many handbell pieces. Those of us who've been familiar with handbell music through the years have appreciated her work. Cynthia Dobrinsky is here today and will be directing the offertory. Cynthia, are you out there? Can raise your hand? Good. It's good to have Cynthia here. Let's welcome all these folks.
And we're delighted you've come. If you're our guest today, in your program, there's a panel that asks some questions. If you don't mind sharing, fill that out, tear it off, and then at the end of the service, when the offering plate comes by you, we want you to drop that in. We'd like a record of your attendance. And this choir is welcome anytime to come back, and so are you. Whenever you're in our area, feel free to drop by. Let's bow our heads together. Lord, it's good to be in your house today. Thank you for waking us up on this beautiful spring morning and giving us the desire to come to church and to come to this one. And Lord, we pray a special blessing upon everyone who's here and those who are watching and those who can't be here for some reason. Lord, I pray you'll bring us all together again soon. And Lord, we pray you'll be honored and blessed in this service and that you'll speak to us through the singing and through the preaching. And when it's all said and done, we will say, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord today. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. We know that worship is not an observation sport. Amen. We want you to sing along with us. Enjoy some sweet, sweet fellowship this morning. There's revival and it's spreading like a wildfire in my heart. Sunday morning, hallelujah, and it's lasting all week long. Can you hear it? Can you feel it? It's the rhythm of a gospel song. Once you choose it, you never lose it, 'cause there ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. I got an old church choir singing in my soul. I got a sweet salvation. It's beautiful. I got a heart overflowing 'cause I've been restored. There ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. I said there ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. the valleys that I wander, turn to mountains that I can climb. You are with me, you'll never leave me. Well, there ain't none gonna steal my joy. I got an old church choir singing in my song. I got a sweet salvation and it's beautiful. I got a heart overflowing cause I've been restored. There ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. I said there ain't
Wow, isn't that great? Isn't it great to be praising the Lord in this place today through song? We have the opportunity to do that too with our very voices. And let's give them a hand again before, as they leave the stage. They have, thank you all so much. Thank you. So they've been at the Lincoln. They sang a concert at the Lincoln Memorial and at the World War II Memorial. They sang on the floor of the House of Representatives. They've sung in the Rotunda. They're going downtown again now to be somewhere else at 12:30. They've been at the Museum of the Bible. So a lot of places where they've been sharing the word of the Lord and the power of the Lord with people in the city. And as you know, it's not just the locals that are all in Washington, D.C. It's people from all over the world. And when they come to America and then visit America, they want to know what Washington, D.C. is like. Let them see God in Washington, D.C. And it's exciting to see what this group has been doing. We appreciate Phil Barfoot's good work in bringing groups. Our choir gets to be a part of one of the Phil Barfoot trips in Italy in August. And so we're looking forward to that as well as we've partnered up in ministry. Let's sing together the great hymn, "To God Be the Glory, Great Things He Has Done." Would you stand and let's sing together? Now sing it out.
To God be the glory, great things He has done. So loved He the world that He gave us His Son, who yielded His life and atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear His voice. Praise the Lord.
Seated.
Please take your Bibles and turn to John's Gospel this morning, chapter 15. We're continuing our series of talks on the seven habits of highly effective Christians. These are very practical messages, not as much theological as some, but very practical, something you can use day by day. The first in the series was about an encounter with God every day, a prayer time, a Bible study and prayer time every day where you get alone with God. Last week, we talked about journaling, writing it down, leaving markers. And this week, several of you have said, I started doing it, Pastor, and I commend you for that. I hope you'll keep on. It's not too late, regardless of your age, to start keeping a record of your days. Now today we come to the third talk, and it's about effective friendships, meaningful, deep friendships. It's very, very important if you're going to be a strong Christian, a boots-on-the-ground Christian who makes a difference, having friends. John chapter 15, beginning at verse 12. My command to you is this, love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that he lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants, because a servant doesn't know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends, for everything that I learned from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last. Then the Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. This is my command, love each other. Pepper Rogers was the football coach at UCLA in the early 1970s. His first season was a disaster. He was miserable, and a lot of folks were turning against him. He wrote later, my dog was my only friend in those days. He told his wife, I think every man deserves at least two friends. So his wife went out and bought him another dog. Now he had two. And you know, a dog is man's best friend, but I hope even if you have a dog, you've got somebody else in your life. It's important to have friends. Who's going to be the attendants at your wedding? Your bridesmaids or your groomsmen? Who are going to be the pallbearers to take you out after you're passing away? Jay Kessler said his goal in life was to have five friends who could come to his funeral and not be looking at their watch the whole time. You have anybody like that? In the supplement to the paper yesterday, the magazine section, this week it was all about the salaries various professions make. And I always check that. I want to see how I'm doing and how you're doing. And I saw something yesterday that I'd never seen before. Maybe it's new. It's possible that your job could be professional bridesmaid. There was somebody there. I think she makes about $36,000 a year. She is a professional bride. I guess she keeps the dress. Maybe that's part of it. But that, how sad is that? That to have your wedding, you have to hire people to stand there for you. Sergio Garcia, the great golfer, at or near the top of his game for decades, has also had some slumps, some embarrassing slumps in his golfing career. He was interviewed by a magazine and he said, when you're on your way up, everybody loves you. But when you are headed down, there will not be so many. At the end of the day, your family and a couple of friends, and that's it. Now, if you add God in the equation, I'd agree with him. When it comes to the end, when life is over, what really matters? Your friends, your family, and your God. Do you have friends in your life? Do you really need them? There are some people who say, I don't need any. I have a friend of mine from years ago. When I first met him, I was interested in being his friend, and he was friendly to me. We were talking about church, and he said, you know, I don't need any more friends. I've got all the friends I can handle now. I don't have time or space in my life for any more friends. Do you really need them? C.S. Lewis once said that friendship is the least natural of loves. Eros love is essential because that's what gets us here. Affection is important because that's how we are reared to being responsible citizens. But friendship, well, that's not so important. I'm going to be bold and differ with the great C.S. Lewis. I think friendships are essential to our lives. Number one, because of loneliness. So many people today are lonely, even in a big church like this, even in a big city like we live in. A lot of hustle and bustle, a lot of people. You're not alone, but you are lonely because there's nobody sharing your life. In our government, you know, we have Secretary of State and Secretary of Defense and Transportation and all the rest. In England, with their system, they have a new minister. She is the minister of loneliness. Tracy Crouch, Theresa May, the prime minister, just appointed the first secretary or minister of loneliness. I'm not sure what the duties are, but the appointment was made because they've discovered in the United Kingdom 9 million people are often or always lonely. These would include the elderly, the caregivers, the grieving, the disabled, refugees. And they've determined that being lonely is worse for your health than smoking 15 cigarettes a day. And I hope you wouldn't do that. But being lonely is just as dangerous to your health. We need people in our lives, lest we be all by ourselves. You see them here on Sundays, people with no one around them. They come by themselves, they leave by themselves, and very few people speak. Loneliness. Everybody needs a friend. Not so many, but two or three in your life to make a difference. Yes, friends are important also as a counterweight to arrogance. You discover it's not all about you. A narcissist lives totally for himself. It's always about him. And who will speak to that? Who can look you in the eye and say, I love you? Too many people with yes people. Nobody ever dares to say, I love you. Have anybody like that in your life who can be honest with you? You can receive it. You can't receive it from just anybody, but you could receive it from the Bible, Proverbs 27, verse 17, that iron sharpens and men together sharpen each other's lives. You have a circle of acquaintances who's sharpening you and making you better. Time magazine, my mailbox yesterday, and the edition I look forward to every year is the one. The 100 most influential people in the world. Well, I take it in and I start pouring through it, and the president is always there, and some entertainers are always there, though they vary. But of the 100 most influential people in the world, I'd not heard of about 95 of them. Never heard of them. So how they're influencing me, I don't know. Maybe they are. Maybe some discovery they're making and they want a Nobel Prize for it that's going to help me eventually. But I don't know it. The most influential people in my life are my closest friends. People who can speak to me honestly. People change other people's lives every day of the year. If I didn't believe that, I'd be out of business. The church wouldn't need to exist. People change other people's lives and influence for God other people's lives every day. Friends are absolutely essential. So my question is, do you have a friend like that? Do you have a friend or two in your life who's influencing you toward God? If you're going to have one, you're going to have to take the initiative. Jesus said in John 15, you did not choose me, but I chose you. He came looking for you. And if you want friends, you got to go looking for them. Jesus would walk along the seashore and he would see some fishermen and he would say to them, come, follow me. They weren't lined up. They didn't ask him, he asked them, come, follow me. When Barnabas needed a co-pastor to work with him, he went and found Saul of Tarsus, brought him back to the city and to the church. Later, Paul went looking for Timothy. Through my life, and I don't know where I learned this, I can't remember being taught it, but maybe I just knew it, that if I were going to have friends, I needed to pursue them. And so when I would see somebody that I wanted to learn from, somebody that I wanted to be like, I would screw up as much courage as I could muster, and I would insinuate myself into their lives. Sometimes I would even say, you know, I would like to be your friend. Would you be my friend? I can't recall anybody ever saying no to that. You've got to initiate. You've got to go looking. Now, if you're going to choose a friend to be your best friend, you've got to choose wisely. This is so important. You can't leave it to happenstance. You've got to choose wisely. The great billionaire Warren Buffett was speaking to a group of students not so long ago, and in the crowd, there was a 14-year-old boy, and he raised his hand during Q&A, and he said, Mr. Buffett, can you give me advice on how to be successful in life? It's a great question for a teenager to ask, and if you're going to ask it, Buffett's a good guy to ask. How can I be successful in life? Warren Buffett said, hang out with people better than you. Pick associates whose behavior is better than yours, and you will drift in that direction. Now, I hope you know that nobody's better than you, okay? God loves you. God made you. Nobody's better than you. You're as good as anybody, and you're better than some, maybe. But you get what he means, don't you? Look around and find somebody who's living the way you want to live one day, and attach yourself to them. Hang out with them, and you will find yourself drifting in that direction. In other words, your mama was right about the companions that you choose, because it works the other way too. If you hang around with people who are living a life contrary to the Bible, living a life of immorality, a life of laziness, they won't study, they won't work, they won't make a difference in this world. Eventually, you will drift that way too. We're getting ready to go to the beach, I guess, all of us, sometime this summer. And have you been to the beach and you let your blanket on the shore and you had an umbrella and you had a lawn chair maybe and you had a cooler and you were ready to enjoy the afternoon? You left it there and you went out into the water. And you swam around for a little bit, and then you came out of the surf to the sand, and none of that stuff was there. It was all gone. And your first thought was, somebody has robbed me. The nerve of them. But then you looked way down the beach, and you saw your umbrella, you saw your chair, your cool. It was all there. It hadn't moved. You had. When you were out there in the water, you were drifting, and it was so subtle, you didn't notice it until you came in. Well, all of us have that tendency to drift in life. And so we need to choose companions who can keep us on course. If you're looking for friends, choose somebody with similar goals as yours. Similar goals. Now, let me explain. I think we need to be friends with a lot of people. In fact, I want to be friends with everybody. And we need to be friendly to everybody we encounter and try to smile in all situations and make people feel welcome, whether it's a party or at church or whatever it is. We need to have friendships across the theological spectrum, and I do, and we need to have friends across the political spectrum. They vote against you every time. Friends from different cultures and different races. All that's meaningful. And we need certainly to have friends who are not Christian. We need to make friendships with people who don't know Jesus. How are we going to win them to Christ if we're not first their friend? And as I've said to you before, invite your neighbor over to your house. Before you invite them to church, invite them to your backyard for a barbecue. Get to know them. Now, you don't do it just to be a witness. You do it to have a fuller life. You do it to have a better neighborhood. But one of the benefits also is you're building a bridge. With every conversation, with every cup of coffee, you're building a bridge over which one day you can walk to carry the gospel to them. So have a lot of friendships. There should always be several in your circle who are not believers. And yet they feel drawn to you, and they enjoy your company, and you enjoy theirs. And you're showing them by the way you live the difference Christ makes. Now, all that being true, your deepest friendships, your best friends, need to be those who share a common faith with you in Jesus. Their outlook on life is the same. Amos chapter 3, verse 3 says, "Can two men walk together except they be agreed?" And that doesn't mean that you agree on everything. That would make things pretty boring. One of you would be unnecessary. The spice of life is to have differences. But on the main things, you are in agreement. Paul wrote in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 14, that we're not to be unequally yoked together with unbelievers. And we often quote that when we're talking about marriage, but that passage really doesn't have anything to do with marriage. It's a principle that applies, but it applies in all of our relationships, that we're not to be unequally yoked. 1 Samuel chapter 18, verse 1, talks about David and Jonathan. And how they were of the same heart, and their hearts were knit together as one. Deep, deep friendship. You have a friend like that? What about a friendship with the opposite sex? Somebody other than your spouse. You're a man. Can your best friend be a woman, not your wife? I'd be very, very careful with that, my friend. Very careful with that. Billy Graham, God rest his soul, is with the Lord now. But you know, it was his pattern and practice throughout his ministry. He would never eat alone with a woman other than his wife, would never be in a car with a woman by himself with her if they weren't married. That was the way he lived his life. That came into the news last year when our vice president, it came out, that was his philosophy too. And boy, he was criticized for it. I mean, Billy Graham, that was a long time ago, but we're in the 21st century. Are we really going to live this way? And I want you to know that most of my life I have lived that way. Not perfectly, not all the time, but that's been basically the way I have lived my life. I think it is wiser. And I would suggest to you that if you have close friendships of the opposite sex, you do not share intimacies about your marriage with that person. We all hit rough spots. We all have those times when it's not so good at home. You don't talk about that to your friend who is of the opposite sex. It's like dynamite. So be very, very careful. Do you have a friend? Somebody says, well, my wife or my husband's my best friend. That's good, but you need other friends too. Those who will stand with you when the going gets tough. The police officer gives you one phone call. Who are you going to call? That wouldn't apply to anybody in the room. That's a bad example. Or you're in some kind of trouble at 3 a.m. Who are you going to call? Who would come without asking questions? Who would be there for you because they love you? Well, I want you to have a friend like that, but before you reach out to them, I want to make sure you've counted the cost. There is a cost involved. It is a huge investment of time. Big investment of time. It takes a long time to grow an old friend, somebody said. So you'll have to pay the price in money and in time to be together. One of the things I so admire about my son, I love everything about him, but one of the things I admire so much about him, he lives in Brazil now, but by the way, immigration is finally moving along, and we hope they're going to be in Texas not so long from now. But he went to college in North Carolina, and ever since graduating 12 years ago, he and his close band of friends still manage to get together once or twice a year. They come from all over the world now, but they get together just to have a good time. I didn't have that experience at all in college. I went from being a high school senior to being the pastor of a Baptist church, and I have no memories of college life. I just wasn't there. But he was, and he has these friendships, and they're deep, and that's so admirable, and I want that, and don't you want that? Most men, women manage to do okay with it, but most men don't have those kinds of friendships anymore. You did in high school, but you don't have them now. It takes time. We've got to pay the price, and the time to do it is now. You know, if you find yourself saying too often, not now, dear, later, because you've got a project to complete or something to do, and when that's done, then we'll have time, then we can get together. You're buying into the illusion that there's always going to be more time later, that there will be a time when you're less stressed and things are less hectic, and you'll do it then. What I'm saying to us today is now is the day not only of salvation, but now is the day to forgive. Now is the time to get over. Now is the time to apologize. Now is the time to be together. Sometimes people ask me, are we living in the end times? And I would say, well, you are. You're living in your end times. You and I are both living in our last days because none of us knows how long we have. We want to develop and keep strong those friendships. It takes, number two, honesty and transparency. If you've got a best friend, you've got to open up. You've got to bare your soul. You can't be keeping secrets. Ephesians 4:25, put off falsehood and speak truthfully one to the other. Jesus said in the John 15 passage, I have made everything known to you. Everything I learned from the Father, I have told you. We need to have friendships. Now, you won't do this with everybody. A lot of folks don't need to know all your business. They don't need to know the difficulties and struggles of your life. But if you don't share with anybody, then you're carrying quite a burden with you. Did you watch Barbara Bush's funeral yesterday? I did. It was a beautiful day to be outside, but I wanted to see that funeral. And it was so beautiful out of St. Martin's Church in Houston. When it was the pastor's turn to speak, he told us that he was the confidant of Barbara Bush, that they would walk and have long talks together. He was her confidant, but he said, you know, when somebody says what's ever on their mind all the time, it's hard to be their confidant. What does it mean to be the confidant if everybody knows always what she's thinking and feeling? Well, not everybody needs to know that stuff, but your friend does. Honesty and transparency. You have a friend like that? There is a friend who sticks closer than a brother, the Bible says. Somebody once said that friends are God's apology to us for our relatives. You can't choose your relatives, but you can choose your friends. And one more thing it takes sacrifice, sacrifice. John 15, verse 13, greater love has no one than this, that he lay down his life for his friends. Is there anybody that you would die for? Is there anybody who would die for you? Now, I know Jesus did, and he is your friend. But aside from Jesus, your spouse, yeah, your parents, your children, anybody else who loves you so much, they would lay down their life for you. That's the friend you need. Like in the classic book, A Tale of Two Cities, Sidney Carton, a ne'er-do-well lawyer, exchanges places with Charles Darnay. They love the same woman, but the woman loves Charles and not Sidney. Now Charles is facing the guillotine in the days of the French Revolution, and Sidney slips into the prison, exchanges places with Charles because they uncannily look alike. They look very similar, just change the clothes. And Sidney Carton goes to the guillotine. And his words are recorded. It is a far, far better thing I do than I have ever done. It is a far, far better rest I go to than I have ever known. It's not much better than being willing to lay down your life for your friend. And it may not be physically to die for somebody, but you give up things for the good of your friend. You have a friend like that, one or two, that's all you need. Lots of acquaintances, a lot of Facebook friends. But if you've got two or three deep friendships, you are ready for the best of the Christian life. I want us to pray together. Bow with me, please. We're going to sing. I'm going to stand here at the front of the room. And if there's somebody today who wants to be a part of our church, we open our doors to you today. Step out and come to me and tell me so. If you have given your life to Jesus privately, but never publicly, you need to do it publicly. So I want to invite you to come and take your stand as a Christian. Or if you want somebody to pray with you about that, then you step out and come. Lord, bless in these moments. And as people have heard your voice, may they respond. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Stand, please, and we sing.
Good morning, church. Would you pray with me? Blessed is the Lord God Almighty, whose mercy and grace we receive daily. Infuse us, Heavenly Father, with the Holy Spirit each and every day, that we may come to know and understand your will for our lives. Jesus spoke of loving others and sharing ourselves and all we have. As stewards of Christ, we are responsible for managing our time, talents, and treasures. Heavenly Father, let us humbly share these treasures with you and our church. As was commanded and followed by your servants of old, let us now give our tithes and offerings unto you, our God and Father, of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. In his name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you, Cynthia.